Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. It's game day. Lakers versus Clippers tonight. No, we're not calling it the battle for LA. Come on. We know who runs LA. It's the purple and gold, but the Lakers do take on the Clippers. Going to be a tough matchup for the Lakers tonight. The Clippers projected to be one of the best teams in the Western Conference, just as the Golden State Warriors projected to be one of the best teams in the West. So that's a tough two-game slate to kick off the season for the Lakers. But what can they do in order to get a win? What are some of the questions swirling around this Lakers team? And what are some of the gambling odds for tonight's game? We're going to break that down. Joining me is Mark Gunnels from LakersNation.com. Mark, how are you doing?
I'm doing good, man. How about you?
I'm apprehensive about this game. You know, the Clippers have had a lot of success against the Lakers in their head-to-head matchups in recent years, and it never feels good. And I'm concerned about this game because when I look at this Clippers roster, they have the team that I want the Lakers to have. When I look at the way that they've structured this team and their wing depth, I would kill to have the kind of wing depth that the Clippers have right now on this Lakers team. So I'm a little bit concerned about how tonight may go, and I'm hoping I'm completely wrong about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think you have every right to be a little concerned about tonight's matchup. As you mentioned, they have a lot of wing depth, just depth in general. I mean, we saw this team last year compete without their two stars for pretty much most of the season. Obviously, Kawhi didn't play, and then PG missed a lot of time as well, and they were still a really competitive ball club, right? Tyronn Lue's a really good coach. He has guys playing hard from every single night. They compete on both ends of the court. They don't beat themselves too, man. That's how you could tell a mark of a great basketball team. They don't beat themselves. So the Lakers are going to have to be on their A game to come away with a win tonight.
Okay, so what do we need to see from the Lakers? I think really the place to start is they need to make their threes, right? I mean, that seems to be, maybe it's an oversimplification, but 25% from three last game, 28% from three when we include the six preseason games and one regular season game. They've got to be better there.
Yeah, I mean, you would like to believe the law of averages would bump up the percentages a little bit. Mm-hmm. Now, we're not going to mistake this team for being a great three-point shooting team because they're not. But 25%, that's really, really bad. So I don't think they're going to shoot that bad tonight. But don't expect them to shoot over 40% or even close to 40%. But I think another thing, though, besides three-point shooting, is the rebounding. I think they had to take advantage on the glass tonight, get some second-chance points, because that's how you combat playing against a team that, on paper, is just more talented than you and deeper. You have to get extra possessions. You can't turn the ball over, especially live ball turnovers. You know, the turnovers that go out of bounds, you know, you still don't like it, but that's okay because the defense can set up. But those live ball turnovers that can create fast break opportunities are really, really dangerous, especially when you're going against a team, like I said, that is just better on paper right now.
Yeah, 21 turnovers against the Golden State Warriors. And look, again, it's an oversimplification. There's a lot of things that the Lakers need to do in order to get this win. But you're not going to win, turn the ball over 21 times, and you're not going to win shooting 25% from three. Both of those things have to be fixed if the Lakers are going to give themselves a shot tonight. What do you do with the starting lineup if you're Darvin Ham? Do you stick with Anthony Davis at the five? Does Damian Jones get minutes? He was the only guy who didn't play at all against the Golden State Warriors. What are you doing there with the starting unit?
I think for right now, you stick with it. I don't think you have to overreact after one game, especially going against the Warriors. I mean, it's the world freaking champions, you know? So I don't think you need to hit the reset button yet on that. But it is something that I would entertain if things don't get better as the games get deeper into the season. But I think right now, I like AD at the five. He played well in the first half, especially that first quarter. They were feeding the ball. He was getting down low. You know, he wasn't really settling for jump shots until later in the game. So I'd like to see him kind of have that mentality for a full four quarters because it's going to open up things even more for the other guys.
Yeah, especially if he can pull Ivica Zubac out on the perimeter and then take him off the dribble. Our old friend Ivica Zubac, who never should have been traded to the Clippers, that still stings. But I think Anthony Davis does have the speed advantage there and may be able to do that on the offensive end, drag him out to the perimeter a little bit and then attack the basket from there. That can collapse the Clippers defense. LeBron, his efficiency doing that as well. And then Russ, I thought Russ was just fine against the Warriors. Can he continue doing that to get in the paint, to live there defensively? The Lakers are going to be challenged to contest the three-point shooters for the Clippers. Story that just came out, though, that was a little bit surprising. Chris Haynes reporting that the Clippers are considering bringing Kawhi Leonard off the bench. What do you think about that? Kawhi Leonard, in order to manage his minutes, like in-game load management, they're going to turn potentially Kawhi Leonard into a reserve. Does that change your approach at all? What do you think about that plan from the Clippers?
I don't think it changes the Lakers' approach, considering they still have a lot of wing depth. You know, they're still going to have size at that position. Obviously, it's not Kawhi Leonard, but it is kind of interesting considering they're talking about managing his minutes, because you could do that with him being a starter. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the confusing part to me, is why they're bringing off the bench to manage his minutes when you can still stagger minutes as a starter. So I don't know. That seems kind of odd to me, especially, you know, it's ironic because it comes back to the Lakers, right, with Russell Westbrook and the preseason game, the last one, he's talking about how that affected him getting injured because he's not used to coming off the bench. So is that a thing that the Clippers may have thought about before they make this decision? I don't know. Something to think about.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, Russell Westbrook is a guy who started almost his entire career, save for his rookie season. And he complained, said, look, you know, coming off the bench was not easy for him to adjust his routine like that. But maybe Kawhi isn't wired that way. Maybe Kawhi says, I don't care. I'm used to sitting on the bench. I did it all last year. I can play coming off the bench. And you know what? When I look at this Clippers lineup, here's the thing about the Clippers. They have so much wing depth. I think they could do this and probably not miss a beat. I mean, you're talking about Marcus Morris is in there. Maybe Luke Kennard, if you want to add more shooting. Nicholas Batum, Norman Powell. You got Terrence Mann. You've got Robert Covington. You have all these guys that you could turn to that you could toss into the starting five and be still a very, very good team. Again, this is why it's a wings league. You have these guys that you can plug in. They're super switchy. They can hit threes. And then you get Kawhi Leonard going up against everybody else's second unit, going up against bench players where he might be able to truly dominate and take over a game. So there's some positives here, but it is weird hearing about a guy who at one point was an MVP candidate. He's won championships, to hear him suddenly coming off the bench and not because of his play on the floor. That strikes me as odd to hear that from the Clippers.
Yeah, and you know, in a weird way though, you got me thinking, it could make them actually more deadlier, because now with that first unit, it's like, okay, this is you, Paul George, because we saw last year, Paul George handled a lot of responsibilities as a ball handler. He was essentially a point forward for them at certain points last year. So now that first unit is kind of his, because you got Reggie Jackson. He's not a traditional point guard. He can play off the ball. He's a pretty good three-point shooter. And then with that second unit, you can be like, okay, this is Kawhi. And then you still got, we haven't mentioned John Wall. John Wall, right? Yep. I forgot he played basketball. He's back tonight. So I'm curious to see how that dynamic works as well, because I think he's coming off the bench too. So you got John Wall and Kawhi come off the bench together. That should be very interesting.
It's a similar dynamic to the Lakers trying to bring Russell Westbrook off the bench, although obviously that turned into a hamstring issue. So it's the same rationale for why you might want to do that if you're the Lakers, to bring Kawhi off the bench. I'll be interested to see how it ultimately plays out and if the Clippers even go there. Most guys that are of Kawhi's caliber, they bristle at the thought of coming off the bench because it's a status thing. But we'll see. We'll see. Either way, look, the Clippers have so much depth on the wing, so much size, so much versatility. This is going to be a game where the Lakers are going to have to really focus on the little things. Boxing out, that's going to matter. Not turning the ball over. Taking advantage of open scoring opportunities, getting to the free throw line, all the little things are going to be magnified in a game like this because the margin for error is going to be so, so slim for the purple and gold tonight. But Mark, let's finish up. Let's get into some of the numbers surrounding this game. I know you've got some betting plays for us. What are you looking at from this matchup?
Yeah, so right now the spread is the Clippers are favored by 5.5. Mm-hmm. I'm not touching it. I feel a little weird about tonight, so I'm not going to touch that. But what I am going to touch is the total points. Right now it's at 225.5. I'm taking the under. I just can't trust the Lakers' shooting ability at this point in the season. And you got going against the Clippers' defense. They're very, very sticky. They're very long and athletic on the wing. And I think with the Clippers, it being their first game of the season, you know, may have a little rust there offensively as well. So I could see a low-scoring defensive battle tonight. So I'm taking the under at 225.5, and I have one player prop actually on the other side. I'm taking the over on Paul George points. Right now it's at 24.5. Considering Kawhi's on a minute restriction, that means more shots for Paul George. And, you know, he gets up for these games, right? Because, you know, he grew up a Lakers fan and, you know, he probably wanted to be a Laker and, you know, it didn't happen. So I think all of that combined with it being the first game of their season, I like him to get the over on 24.5. So the under total points, 225.5, and the over on Paul George points at 24.5.
All right, so I like it. So betting against the Lakers shooting, which based on what we've seen so far is probably a good idea. And then I do think there's some regression to the mean, some positive regression coming for the Lakers. I don't know if it's going to happen tonight or not, though. But and then Paul George, betting on him to have a big night against the Lakers. We've seen it in the past. Depending on which story you believe from Paul George, at which time he was talking, he was either a Lakers fan or maybe not so much or whatever. But there was some long building animosity for the Lakers from Paul George. He was upset that the Lakers back in the day didn't give up what they needed to the Indiana Pacers to go get him. He wound up being traded to the Thunder. And then I think that played a role in him becoming a Clipper and not a Laker in free agency like they thought he was going to. Instead, winds up jumping to the Clippers in a trade. So all of that is a long-winded way of saying, I'm with you, Mark. I think that those are both pretty solid plays. And we'll see if anybody's tailored on those. Good luck. Hopefully you're able to win some money tonight. And hopefully, fingers crossed, the Lakers can pull the upset here. We saw a lot of upsets in the NBA last night. Why not us? Why not the Lakers get an upset win here over the Clippers? Would certainly be needed by the LA fan base. But Mark, thanks so much for coming on here. Appreciate it. And let's go Lakers tonight, huh?
Yes, sir. Let's get a win, man.
That's right. That would be fantastic. To get a win tonight would be uplifting and much needed. Lakers Nation, give us your thoughts in the comments down below. And don't forget, subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Of course, come join us over on Playback for the live stream of Lakers versus Clippers. Going to put a link in the description. Till next time, see ya and stay safe.